Hi, I'm Paulshinn. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, the only automotive YouTube channel where OK Boomer is a compliment. In the last edition of Operation Hooptie, you saw this car come out of the garage. We got this car running, got this car on the trailer, brought it home, and here it sits. So Operation Hooptie got a name. This car is now Athena. It runs, and as you can tell, it's got a lot of dirt and grunge on it. Also a lot of modifications. So we were trying to figure out, where do we start with this car? And obviously we have to do all the fluids and all that, but I'm not talking about that so much. I'm talking about, where do we start in where we get into the meat of this thing? So there's modifications all over it. The wiring is atrocious. There's even modifications underneath this car to the chassis. So we have to figure out, are these modifications because they were trying to repair something that was broken? Were they trying to improve something? Were they just trying to change it just because? Did they read the web forums and got a lot of bad advice? I don't know. So we have to kind of tear into this car and just get down to the nitty gritty, down to the bare bones, so we can figure out what's going on with this thing. Now, obviously a lot of the visual modifications, I mean, it looks like this car could have been owned by Elvis or something, but other than that, the actual mechanical modifications of this car, there really is a reason to remove a lot of that just to see what's going on. But we went to the polls. So a couple of weeks now, there's been a poll running on the community page here. Where should we go with this car? Should we restore it back to just totally bare bones factory stock? Should we go stock with just a couple modifications for drivability? Should we, you know, mild hot rod it? Should we totally hot rod it, put an LS in it, and do what all the other automotive YouTube channels do to cars like this? So the overwhelming response from that poll is, we should go ahead and restore this car with a few modifications to make it more drivable. Since the goal was to take a car that's been sitting for, in this case, decades, and turn it into a car that we can take on tours and drive around, maybe not necessarily drive every day to work and stuff like that, but at least a reliable touring car. So that's where we're gonna head with Athena here. So thank you very much for everybody who participated in the poll. Very, very helpful. Especially when you have something like this, or you're just not sure, what do we do with this thing? But number one thing we need to do is we need to get the gunge off of this car. I need to see what's going on with this thing. See if we have any rust issues or anything big to repair. I already found a fender repair that needs to be done pretty soon, but we don't really know what's going on because of all the dirt and grunge. Now, I admit, this car looks a lot better on camera than it does in person. For whatever reason, they say the camera adds 10 pounds. Well, I probably have about 8 cameras pointed at me, but the camera also removes dirt for some reason. So trust me, it looks a lot worse in person, and inside isn't the prettiest either. So first thing I think we're gonna do, I'm gonna take my wife's suggestion. I'm gonna clean this thing up. Just get the grunge off and see where we are with this thing. So the first step is to get it out of the shop and get it into the wash bay, which just happens to be on the other side of that wall. Okay, it's here in the wash bay. So the first step, I guess, is to get all the stuff ready, and I gotta get me ready too. So I'm gonna do this the way Aging Wheels does it. First thing I need to do is get about 30% more naked. All right, that'll work. Now I just need my bucket, my soap, and a washcloth. Oh, wait, here it is. Oh, so the way Aging Wheels does it is the best way. Okay, now normally I wouldn't use a hose and water and soap and such crass methods to clean a Model A. In fact, my other Model A's have never even seen a garden hose. But this needs it. So I guess I'll just get started. Thank you.
The more dirt, grease, and grunge I was getting off of the car, the more obvious it was becoming. It. This body's in perfect condition. There's no rust anywhere on this thing. Now, granted, the paint kind of sucks. It looks like it was applied with a paintbrush, and even then, probably a paintbrush while somebody was drunk. But the fact is, the body on this thing, zero rust. Yeah, there's a few dents here and there. It needs a little bit of work, but not a whole lot. Removing all that grunge exposed more than just the paint. A lot of flaws. For example, a threading die used as a lug nut. And you remember those stickers on the back? They were just printed on paper and glued to the car. They turned to goo and fell off when they got wet. And all these little paint touch-ups everywhere. Millions of them. Not to mention that right front fender. This repair's going to be a little bit more involved than I thought. And how do you keep your roof from leaking if you don't care what it looks like? Thick black silicone all the way around the vinyl part. And then you repair a crack in the window with stickers. I don't know why they did that. Paint drips everywhere, but you know what? The car was looking a little bit better, so I thought, what the heck. Let's go ahead and clean the white walls, and even though I'm not a big white wall fan, they just look better when they're clean. But that also exposed another issue I hadn't expected. Even the tires are mix-matched. 3 Goodyears and 1 Firestone. Well, let's just start by taking a look at some of the underhood modifications to Athena here. Well, first of all, I talked about this in the video where we just got the car running again. And this is a radiator overflow that has some coolant in it, tubing connected to the radiator. It has an alternator instead of the generator. This alternator is a 12-volt alternator, which was our first clue that something is amiss with this electrical system. So this was converted to 12-volt negative ground. And in doing so, somebody installed a 12-volt ignition coil here, but they also have the resistor in series that you would normally use if you have a 6-volt coil and you go to a 12-volt electrical system. But now they installed a 12-volt coil and the resistor that you would use if you had a 6-volt coil. So I don't know what web forum that poor advice came from. You never know with these. But anyway, it's got this added chain here holding this cap so you don't lose it. This is some weird oil breather system thing. So normally the vent cap here is just out in the open, but if your engine has a lot of blow-by, your engine's kind of old, worn out, people buy these as an aftermarket accessory that just kind of vents that under the car so you don't get a bunch of oil and fumes into the passenger compartment. And okay, if you got an engine with a lot of miles on it and it's getting kind of worn out, fine. But this one here is just super, I can't tell you how greasy and gross this one is. It just doesn't come through on camera. There's a bunch of weird wiring. So this apparently they're using as a ground point for all this weird extra wiring that this car has. And underneath is even worse, but not sure what all that's about. Nice adjustable link here on the timing advance lever. So I don't know, it just wasn't right. This is one of my favorites. Looks like a 9mm wrench just hanging here for some weird reason. Model A's are not metric, they're SAE last I looked. But at least they have the safety fuse here on the starter. I'll give them that, but there's all this extra. Well, no wonder, with all that extra wiring, we probably need the safety of the fuse there. That was more than just convenience or safety, it was probably necessary. Anyway, blue fan, that should be black, but four-bladed fan instead of the stock two-blade that flies apart, that's fine with me. Why paint this blue? I don't know, whatever, I'm just being nitpicky, I guess. Non-Model A hose clamps, boy, these hoses are just about done. Oh, they're cracking. I don't even want to push on it too hard to need to do those. It's got the motor mounts already in it, and they are completely flat. There's no rubber left in there at all. Yeah, lots of work to do under here. Let's go take a look at the other side. As the sun shines on the passenger side of Athena's motor, and remember, we rebuilt the distributor, although I didn't do it the way I really like doing it. I did it with the wireless lower plate, which I don't like those, but it had a makeshift wireless lower plate in it, and I just happened to have a brand new wireless lower plate that I'd never used and wanted to get rid of it, so I got rid of it by installing it in there. We rebuilt the carburetor, removed the modifications of that, so these two are good to go. Now, the rest of this is pretty sus still, so there's this wire that just seems to go down here, and I'm not sure, maybe that's for the oil pressure gauge, perhaps. This is full of crud. This needs to get cleaned out big time. There's even stuff just floating in it. Oh, and look, it's just leaking like crazy now. Perfect, I shouldn't have touched it. It's just spilling gas everywhere. Okay, let's continue on here. So some more wires that go nowhere, just floating around. This obviously goes to that water temp gauge inside. Looks like they installed it with JB Weld. That's not sus at all. There's that resistor in series with the coil I was talking about. And of course, it's nice and loose here. Perfect. That's nice and sus. I think I'll be getting rid of that too. So we're probably going to end up just putting a whole wiring harness in this car is my guess. So if we do that, then we won't need half of that. I'll have to rip all that out. So at least that'll be better. And then I can redo the wiring to the lights and all this super sus wiring here. Ugh, these wires feel terrible. I feel like they're just going to fall apart at any moment. So there we go. There's some of the underhood modifications. Now we got to look inside. Okay, let's take a look at the interior of Athena here, and we'll get an idea of what we got to work with. Now, interestingly enough, after washing the car with a hose, not one drop of water inside the car. I couldn't believe it. This car didn't leak a drop. Probably has to do with all that silicone they put around the top or something. But anyway, dry as a bone in here, although still pretty filthy. The interior cloth is in decent shape. Some of the buttons have kind of come loose, as you can see here. We're going to have to do some work on that. I think my wife will have something to say about that. But check this out. Error correct wool blanket. Free. Yeah, came with it. It has the shade, which has no spring left in it. A couple spare parts came in the tray. And now, all that looks good. So we'll just pan to the front and now you'll change your mind. So there's this interesting little homebrew drink holder thing here. And it's like, oh, well, what's that? Other than holding the drink, does it have any purpose? Yes, as it turns out, here's the choke rod. And as you can see, there's this makeshift thing here that holds the choke rod because the real thing that's supposed to hold the choke rod is missing. And it looks like the fuel tank was repaired under here. It must've ripped out or something. So they made this, which holds the choke rod kind of loosely. Well, it sort of works. A couple added gauges here. This one is mounted just with the typical mount that all the part suppliers sell, even though it's loose. This one, I'm a little worried about. I think this is mounted by screwing into the tank. And unfortunately, if that's the case, this is gonna be one of those deals where we're gonna have to do some welding to fix the tank. But there are two screw heads under this. And I really think they go into the tank. I sure hope not, but I kind of think that's what they do. Here's some of the extra sus wiring. Here's a 12-volt fan mounted in the car, which, oddly enough, although the motor kind of turns, it's a little stiff, it does not work. Some sus wiring with some extra fuse holders and things. Some of this wiring goes to things. Some of it goes absolutely nowhere. And thank goodness, thank God above, this car has a fire extinguisher, which it would definitely need based on the condition of the electrical system. Unfortunately, it appears to have been used already because it's almost completely empty. And the piece de resistance is this neat glass shift knob, which is fantastic, except that it's broken in a couple of places. And if you touch it just right, it cuts your fingers. So when you shift this, you just kind of put your hand on top and do this. Otherwise, if you grab it around, you'll cut yourself like I did right there. So yeah, that's gonna go for sure. So anyway, there's Athena on the inside, which luckily is not as bad as underside. I've mentioned before that I am already in the works on a video called the Ford Model A Buyer's Guide to show you what you should look for and what you should avoid. And when I get this car up on the lift, you'll see a good example of what you should avoid. After the last video, and with nothing to lose really, I went ahead and just put a couple clicks on all the brake adjustments just so I could get enough stopping power to where I felt comfortable putting the car on the lift. So now let me take you on a tour of Athena's underside. Wait a minute, that didn't sound right. Just never mind. Okay, let's start from the front here. And the first thing is some interesting wires that appear to go up to these lights up here that don't seem to really work anyway. There's kind of a funny mount here for the front spring. Looks like that was added. Interesting. Okay, there's a funny ground here between the engine block and the frame. And then this, which I'm not really sure what this does. It's kind of unusual. Let's go over here. This is where Athena starts to get super sus because there's some added things here. Not sure what all this does, but here is the psychedelic spaghetti that this car calls wiring. It begins up here and it only gets worse as you progressively move back. Now here under the steering box, you'll see somebody stuffed a bunch of whatever this material is to try and soak up oil, I presume. But why? There's this tin can, the sardine can, kind of wired right here. I guess that was to catch the oil out of the steering box, I presume. Then there's this. This is that tube that comes off of that weird breather cap that's on this thing. I don't know how much blow-by this really has. We haven't really run it a lot yet. This clear plastic tubing that goes up to that overflow that somebody added up top. Move back just slightly further, and here's an added spring with a hose clamp. This car has lots of added hose clamps. This appears to be something to pull the brake pedal back, I guess. More super sus wiring over here. Lots of grease and grime. And here's that 12 volt lawn tractor battery we put in just to get the car started. Now we put a 12 volt battery in it, and I know this is supposed to be 6 volt positive ground, but this car obviously was converted to 12 volts at some point because it has all 12 volt light bulbs in it, and there was that weird resistor on the 12 volt coil and everything. So muffler here looks like a spring added to the emergency brake mechanism, I guess, to help pull the emergency brake back. And that's about a C minor, I think, something. Wired up speedometer cable. A lot of modification here. Another one of those mystery hose clamps that's just there for whatever reason. More sus wiring that just goes kind of nowhere. And some of it goes somewhere and some of it doesn't. Lots of spider webs from the feel of it. Feels like Black Widow. Now this is where it starts to get funny. There's a bunch of little stuff like this. This goes up into the pan under the seat. Inside, nothing. Under here, somebody added this strip of aluminum across, and it looks like they were going to add seat belts or something, but this car doesn't have seat belts, so I'm not sure really what that's doing. More sus wiring just hanging down there. Grease, grime. This car is so greasy, it's going to take me days to clean up under here. Maybe that's a whole video unto itself. Anyway, it's got one of those cheapy repro mufflers. It doesn't have the nice Aries muffler. Although these, I think these sound better, but they're a little restrictive. But exhaust tip's been added on, and of course it just blows the exhaust back towards the passenger compartment of the car when you do it like this, so that's not a lot of help. So this is where Athena starts to get super sus. Check this out. So here is the rear cross member. Now this is where the rear leaf spring mounts. Okay, now here is these metal pieces of channel. This is added, and then this is like a Model A front bumper piece or something that somebody cut off and put in there. It's kind of springy. Here's another piece. These are welded to the horizontal cross member here, the frame cross member, on both sides. Either just welded right here. Here's a real ugly, feels like they just did it with a stick welder and then painted over it. And that's how these are mounted. And there's another weld up inside here. You probably can't see it, but that's how these two pieces are tested. They're bolted together here. And then there's a block of wood. Let's see if I can get this. There's a block of wood right here that I guess that sandwiches. And what does that do? I don't know. Obviously the previous owner got some more bad advice from one of the web forums, and that's supposed to do something. I'm not sure. So looking at the rear cross member, it doesn't appear to be damaged or anything, but I don't know. I mean, it's hard to tell. There's a little marks here where they put the spring back in, wanted to find out where center was. That's just grease pencil. So I don't know, some weirdness. At least it has shocks, I'll say that, but it has the V8 style shock arms, unfortunately. More sus wiring. People, please don't ever use wire nuts under your Model A. Never, please. Another, you know, wire coming out the hole. Here's a, yeah, that's your first clue that this thing is really sus. And then there's these added on lights on the rear here that, I don't know, I guess that was for visibility, even though they don't work. Then there's these weird mud flaps. So it looks like they just kind of made some kind of a weird bracket here and just bolted it to the fender brace. And although these are, you know, who knows how old, they're semi-pliable. They feel like they're going to break if you push them too far. But they do say Ford, so they look like they're supposed to be there, I guess. But anyway, more sus wiring going up here, up to this extra little added light up here. Athena, this is going to be a lot of work putting this car back to stock, but that's what you guys indicated you wanted in the poll, so that's what we're going to do. But I don't even know where to start. I mean, I need to get a look at the inside of the motor, so maybe I'll just start by pulling the oil pan. I'll drain all the fluids out of it. I'll pull the oil pan and just get a look at what the bottom side of the motor looks like. Hopefully it's in decent shape. But I don't know. They added this little pan right here, I presume, to catch oil spills, and it's full. So it's definitely been catching oil coming out of the rear main. I don't know where to go with this thing. I guess, I don't know, maybe I should just start by doing a big degreasing on this or something so I can see what I'm looking at. I don't know. Either way, I got to pull the oil pan because I got to see what the bottom of the motor looks like. I don't even know if this thing has insert bearings or if it has Babbitt. I guess we just need to kind of start there. So Athena supposedly was the goddess of war, but in this case, Athena is the goddess of grease, grime, and poor maintenance. Anyway, next video in this series on Operation Hooptie, I'm going to get my hands really, really greasy. Meanwhile, thank you so much for watching, but first there's a few people I want to thank. Arthur Holtshue, thank you so much for becoming a new supporter of this channel. Also David Weiss and Greg Heiss, thank you so much for your donations. People like you that help keep projects like this coming your way. So although I know we have a few millennials who watch this channel, according to YouTube analytics, pretty much everybody is my age that watches these videos. So if you're a millennial, you're out there, please let me know. Just go down in the comments, please, and just reply, okay, boomer. Just let me know you're there. Appreciate that. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. I will catch you on the next video where these hands will become very, very greasy.